Hello, welcome. So, we are discussing in the last class the gravity concentration and in general, and we had started discussing about the sluices. So, this was the earlier designs of the sluices. This is relatively your improved design. What it is being tried, that is, say suppose gold, when you have a free gold, and so they are in ppm level, that is, ppm level means it may be around 2 ppm or 3 ppm, and if they are fine free gold, so that means in 1 ton of material, that is, in 1000 kg of material, you are having on an average of 2 to 3 grams of gold. So, in that case, what we can do, that is, if we have a channel like this, and if you have some kind of your gaps, that is, in between, that is, you call it the capturing riffles. So, what will happen? The gold particles will be captured, and they are very high settling velocity particles, because their density is 19,000 kg per meter cube. And most of the your unwanted materials, they are mostly silicates and all this, they are around 2650 kg per meter cube. And if I have a high velocity of your flowing water, so these gold particles get captured here, and you are just taking out the gold, and it can be a batch process also. And you may have a concentrated form of these gold particles here, and after you remove it from them, you can take out your free gold particles. So, this is one of the techniques, but nowadays you hardly get fine free golds. So, now, so this is another way of representing that, that is what I was trying to say, that this is the flow direction, and for a flowing film concentrator, you have got a film thickness. So, if I have a your splitter at this, imagine it is splitter. So, I will have the overflow, that is the tailings, that is your lighter particles, and these are your heavy mineral concentrate. So, most of the cases, relatively heavier fraction is my wanted material. So, you can have a separation of the concentrate and tailing. This is another design, that is, your flow is going towards this, and you have a pinch, that is, you are trying to increase the flow depth at the towards the end, towards the discharge. Why? No, here you have got a very thin film thickness, and now here you want to have a your much of a pull of that water, of that fluid. So, what will happen? The you can have much more your segregation, or maybe your splitter positioning will be easier, because here you may have a film thickness of around 2 millimeter. But within that 2 millimeter, it is very difficult to have a splitter at a position of say 0.5 millimeter. But if that 2 millimeter, if I increase to your depth of 20 millimeter, I can easily have a splitter. So, that is also another modification to this design. Now, this one is telling that by applying this principle, these are all textbook things, that what is the mean size and what is the recovery percentage. You see that as the particle become finer and finer, this way of separating particles becomes the recovery gets your deteriorated faster. If your mean size is 10,000 microns, the recovery could be 100%, that means it is possible. If you design it properly, if you monitor the flow conditions accurately, up to 1200 microns, the recovery is 100%. Now, if its size becomes 800 micron, it becomes 67 like that. When it becomes 90 micron meters, it will be like your 12% recovery. So, that means it is not applicable for very fine separation at very fine size ranges, but there are if we can control it properly, that feed flow rate and your the film thickness, and then other the splitter positioning appropriately, then probably we can achieve this for relatively coarser size ranges of particles. There is another version of this, that is relatively modern design, improved design I would say, of this flowing film concentrator. This is known as ray cut cone. So, here what we try to do? We try to increase the capacity, because you have seen that there the unit capacity may be less, and what you try to do? You try to do it in stages, like you have a feed here and you have got these surfaces and you want to spread that feed into these two surfaces, and because of the gradient here, the feed in the form of slurry, they will start traveling, and when they start traveling, you will have a film formed, and within that film there will be a separation with that similar principle. So, what will happen? At the bottom you will have more of this concentration of relatively heavier material, and on the top you will have the lighter materials. So, when the your lighter stream, when it is collected here, we are collecting light minerals, and the bottommost one is the heavy minerals. So, that is basically, it can work up to 400 mes in theory, you have to convert it into micrometers. These are some of the your designs of your many flowing film concentrators. It is a version of your modified ray cut cones, or maybe the ray cut cones itself also. Another this is another piece of equipment which is fundamentally working based on that flowing film principle, but on top of that we are adding some other forces, some other mechanism to improve the separation performances. These are known as tables. This is tables. Now, what you do, that is, here you have got a feed and this is a slightly inclined. So, this is inclined like this, and the deck, we call it deck, the deck is also inclined. So, the feed in the form of slurry, that is your heavy and light particle mixture with water, you are feeding it here, and then you have got the riffles here. These are the artificially made riffles. These riffles could be made of wood, or it may be by some other materials also. Earlier it is used to be made by wood. So, now when the feed is entered here, and because of that, and then you shake the machine, shake the entire table a bit like this, and because of that what happens, the material, the your slurry starts flowing in this direction. So, what will happen, and you keep on, you add some water also, so that you maintain some kind of your consistency in the flow rate and the thickness of the flow. So, what will happen, your heavier particles will be captured in between the riffles, and your lighter particles will just slide, because just imagine that if I have a table, it is just like your this screen like this, it is tilted, and say suppose this is slightly angled like this, inclined, then what will happen, your material is fed from here. So, the fluid will try to flow like this. Now, when the fluid is flowing like that, you have a film. Now, within that film, that your heavier material are getting captured, because they are at the bottommost layer and you are not allowing them to travel faster. So, what will happen? This material are basically captured here, and the top layer, that is your lighter, relatively finer or lighter materials, they are carried by the water, because and then they are, that is called the tailing side. So, that is you are having your lighter material here. So, now once the heavier material are captured here, you are adding more water here gently, so that how much of water you will be adding, because if it is too high, then again this captured material may be in suspension. So, you lose this material, and this material you are allowing them to travel through this, and you are collecting it through that, that is called the concentrate end. So, here the trick is mainly what should be the your height of each refill and what should be the distance between each refill, because when the fluid is moving traveling through this, because of the hindrance offered by the refills, the flow may become turbulent. So, it may try to lift the particles which are already captured in between the your refills, they may be again say reporting through the tailings, that is your final material. So, these are the basically the operating and design variables, and what should be the length of this, what should be the gradient, and what should be the angle of tilt, all these are basically the variables. So, this is the tables in a particle action in a flowing film, that is your I have already discussed about it, that how it will work, but this is only a explanation almost for some a few particles. It is not that simple. When you are dealing with millions of particles, it becomes little bit complicated, but that much of information is enough to understand whatever I have explained, that how it works. Okay. This is basically in detail of the how the table works and what is the wash water and feed zone and direction of movement, that is I said that your deck also moves like this. So, what is the direction of movement? Why you want the movement of the deck? Now, because I want the fluid to travel like this in this direction. So that my lighter particles, they are basically reporting through this end. They do not get diverted to my concentrated end. Now, there are also the wet sinking tables. There are different varieties of tables. Now, and they were they used to be very popular in gold industry, in tin processing industry, where the differences in the densities between the heavies and the lights were very high. So, these are again the stacked sinking table, like you can have multiple tables, like you can have this your lighter materials what is coming here. If you are not very sure that they are free from any gold particles or any of your heavier particles. So, you put it into another table and you try to do it, and when you are very sure that you are not losing much of your valuable mineral, then you are saying that that is my reject. Okay. And this is another your relatively modern version of these your sinking tables, and sometimes they are being stacked like this to minimize the floor space occupied for a given capacity. So, what are the operating variables for this tabling? It is the tilt angle, it is the splitter positions, that is how where from you will split it, the stroke length, that is feed rate, and wash water flow rate. But this is not that popular these days in mineral processing industries. We have got many more modern equipment than this. So, what we have learned about the flowing film concentrators. Now, what I said that there are some modern equipment based on that flowing film principle, it is one of them is spiral concentrator, which is becoming very popular these days in across many mineral processing industries because of many advantages associated with it. It is called a spiral concentrator. As a spiral concentrator have found many varied applications in mineral processing and in recent years in the recovery of fine coal even. It is composed of a helical conduit or modified semicircular cross sections like this. So, what we are trying to do? We are trying to use the height so that I can use the gravitational force field, as well as the it is having a helical conduit. I just try to show you in the with the next slide that what is happening, that we are feeding the material, that is in the form of slurry on the from the top, and then you have got a helical conduit like this. So, the fluid is traversing like this. So, that fluid is now a slurry mixture of your water plus your heavies and light particles, they are traversing like this. And there you have got a gradient also here, what is being shown here, that you have got a gradient in this direction. And because of that, now it is more clearer. So, what will happen when the slurry is coming from top and it is going like this, it is a spiraling. So, the particles are also experiencing to some extent some centrifugal force, because now it is in rotating motion, it is like this. So, what will happen? The heavier particles will be relatively heavier particles. So, you are having a thin film of fluid, and the particles are also experiencing a bit of centrifugal force. So, because of these two, that is, or because of gravitational phenomena, force field, and which is replaced by some kind of your centrifugal force field, and because of the relative motion of the fluid at each layer of the fluid across the your say y axis. So, the heavies will be settled towards this region, and the lighter particles will be much more concentrated towards the upper zone, because they are being transported through the top layer of the film. And in between, if you have in between some particles which are having in between density, they will be concentrated here. So, it is your phenomena what we observe if we take a beach pressure mineral, like where you have got different density particles. That is the very first picture I have shown you of one of the when I gave this example of how nature is doing the gravity concentration. So, that is the material, if I put it into a spiral. So, the lighter particles, that is your sand particle, will be concentrated in this region. Your the heaviest particle, that is the ilmenite, that is this particle, will be concentrated here. In between density particles will be concentrated here. So, that is how you have a separation, and then you are having different turns like this. So, it keep on doing this, and you have a splitter at the end of this, that is, and that splitter is basically helping you to separate the heavies, lights, and your middlings. Normally, what are the conditions for this flow conditions? Now, feed pulp of between 15% and 45% solids by weight, it is not by volume. So, feed pulp of between 15% and 45% solids by weight, and in the size range 3 millimeter to 75 micrometer, it depends on what density range you are playing with, is introduced at the top of the spiral. And as it flows spirally downwards, the particles stratify due to the combined effect of centrifugal force, the differential settling rates of the particles, and the effect of interstitial trickling through the flowing particle bed. What is this interstitial trickling? Now, when I have a coarser particle bed formed, so there will be some void spaces in between these coarser particles. So, these void spaces will be occupied by relatively finer and heavier particles, and that is the meaning of this your interstitial trickling. In practice, the spirals are arranged in stacks or modules of roughers, scavengers, and cleaners. What is the roughers? Why do you keep it in stacks? Now, the spirals are normally designed like we have why stacks? Now, I need much more residence time of the particles to decide that whether I will be in the concentrate zone or the tailing zone. And many times what happens that you may lose some of your heavier particles in the tailing stream. or maybe sometimes your heavier particle stream, they are not that concentrated of my desired quality. So, what we do? We have got stacks of spirals. So, suppose you have got 5 turn spiral here. So, we generally depict the use the terminology of the how many turns you have. So, suppose you have got 5 turns spiral. So, that is not enough to give you the right kind of product. So, what we do? Depending on where I will have more of misplaced materials, I divert that into your another set of spirals, and we keep on doing it. It may be your, say, your stack of 3 spirals like that, and then we try to do it. So, it is decided based on that how much of that valuable material is there and how much of purity we want by my spiral separated to give me a concentrate. Many times these are stacked because we want to do the separation in stages, like what you do in other cases like your screening, that is we do it in stages. We have got your primary crusher, then secondary crusher, then tertiary crusher. Here we name them as roughers, that means the whatever the easily separable mineral, that we try to separate it in the first go. Next one we try to further clean it, and then in the cleaner section we try to clean it further and further. So, where the initial concentrate is retreated to upgrade the fraction to its final grade, that is first I try to recover most of the heavier mineral into my concentrate stream, but when I try to do it, when I try to increase the recovery, that means the grade will be deteriorated. That means some coarse light particle may also be reported through my in my concentrate stream. Then next stage I try to remove some of them, and the final stage I try to remove most of them, so that I get a finer, cleaner concentrate. Spiral length is usually 5 or more turns for roughing duty and 3 turns in some cleaning units, because more the turns, more the residence time, so lesser the capacity per unit volume of this spiral we are having. So, we give more residence time in the your roughing duty, and for some cleaning stages we give more lesser residence time. But it is not a fixed rule. It depends on what is your material and what is that you want your spiral to do. For coal washing, normally 6 turns providing a gentler slope with longer residence time are used for the more difficult separation. For coal, the density difference between your coal and shell particle is much less. That is why you need more residence time. But so, it is dictated by the concentration criteria and the differences in the particle sizes. That means, what is their settling velocity differences. If the settling velocity differences is much higher, we need lesser turn, that is we need lesser residence time. If the settling velocity difference is less, then we need more residence time to separate it based on this principle. Spirals generally achieve an upgrade ratio of 3:1, that is heavy fraction is of feed grade, that is your ratio of upgradation is 3:1, and hence multiple treatments are required. That means, in one go in a set of spiral, that is you can have a upgrading ratio of 3, like it is analogous to a gain, that is what is your reduction ratio, that is instead of in place of crusher. So, I want my material to be upgraded 25 times, then in each stage I will have an upgrade ratio of 3. So, I may need 8 sets of spirals. Whether that is economically viable, logistically possible, that is a different thing, but theoretically we need more than 8. The presence of slimes adversely affects the spiral performance. Slimes in general in any water based processes, it will have adverse effect. That is, slimes means ultra fine particles, because as I had repeatedly said that slimes will increase the viscosity of your fluid in general, and your recyclable water, recycling of water also becomes very difficult, because it is very difficult to get rid of these very fine particles. So, more than 5% of minus 45 micron slimes will affect the separation efficiency. That means, if I have more than 5% of below 45 micrometer particles, in general it has been observed that the separation efficiency gets affected in a spiral. Now, what is the material of construction of spirals? Now, spiral concentrators can be made with multiple stars, that is multiple spirals interwound to save floor space. Sorry, we will come back to the material of construction later on. So, that is like that, that is, you can have multiple stars, like as I had shown you in the previous picture, that is, you can have a stack of your spirals. Up to 3-star spirals have been reported, which would essentially give 3 spirals in about the same space that one would take up. That is, I can have three sets of spirals, and each spirals could be of your 5 turns. That means, it all together you will having 15 turns. So, your structural stability is a very important factor for that. You have to take care of that. Normally, it is common to see that your 3-star spirals are in operation in the plant. Spiral concentrators are normally used in banks of multiple spirals. I will show you some pictures of that. We can have multiple your banks also, and banks of spirals, like it is again analogous to your small diameter cyclones, how they are basically assembled together to meet the required or desired capacity. Typical capacities for spirals run from 1 to 3 tons per hour of feed for minerals, and 3 to 5 tons per hour for coal. So, you see that it is very, each spiral is having relatively much lesser quantity, lesser capacity. So, if I need a 100 tons of material to be processed per unit time per hour, so we need at least 33 or 35 your parallel say spirals lined in some manner. So, that is called the basically the bank of spirals. We need multiple spirals to meet the your capacity requirement. Typical construction of a spiral concentrator, that is the material, is fiberglass and urethane to reduce wear from abrasion, because the bottom layer will be severely your worn out if your material is not your wear resistant material, because the relatively coarser and heavier particle will be always traveling through your floor. So, if that material has to be abrasion resistant. So, normally it has been seen that fiberglass and urethane are the best material to be used for spiral manufacturing. What are the operating variables for spirals? It is the feed rate. It is normally, we have seen that it is 1 to 6 tons per hour per spiral start, depending on the ore characteristics. Feed density, that is your pulp density, 25 to 50% solids, depending on the purpose for what you are using the spiral, that whether the spirals you are using for only for roughing duty or up to the final cleaning stages. Then splitter positions, where you are positioning the splitters, that is, how do I know that how much of that your floor space is occupied by the concentrate and by the middling and by the your lighter minerals, that is your tailings. So, these are some of the summary of your spiral operating variables and their effect. Like feed size, it normally varies except from 3 millimeter to 75 micrometer, and optimum size for coal, this is for optimum size for coal, and it can go up to 0.85 millimeter, that is 850 micrometer to 45 micrometer for minerals. Feed rate could be 1 to 5 tons per hour, depending on the design capacity. It works best that 20 to 30% solids by mass, less for fine sands. If you have the very fine sand which are having lesser density also, it could be less. Feed percent solids up to 50% solid for coarse feed, high percent solids for high recovery and low grade. That is, if you have high percent solids, so recovery will be high, but grade will be low. It is all common phenomena. Low percent solids, high heavy fraction grade. That means quality will be good, but your capacity will be less. Splitter position depends on feed properties and required duty, and that need that requires the understanding of how spiral works, and also it depends on what is the material characteristics and your experience also. This is a simplified process flow sheet. That is, this is the, we are calling it stack of spirals. That is, you have got your spirals and you see that your some product you are taking it out and you are classifying and then dewatering it and sending it back, sending it to either the reject stream, and then you are trying to clean it further and further until you get the final concentrate. This is nothing but the screens and your grinding circuits, because you have to prepare your feed to a particular size for the liberation. So, this is the comminution circuit, this is the processing circuit, and this is the your final, your checking, that is your classification and your thickening circuit, and your this water you are basically trying to recycle it back. So, this is in short about the spirals, and you see that this shows that your plant iron recovery versus particle size. These are the some data I have got it from literature, that as the particle size decreases, the percentage iron recovery becomes less, and with the coarser sizes the recovery increases, but when the sizes become much coarser, again it deteriorates because it cannot move. So, you do not have a flowing film separation when the particles become very coarse. So, you have an optimum size range for the spirals to separate your material. This is the how they are stacked, like I need to match the capacity. It is just analogous to how you have stacked the cyclones. That is, you have your different your stages, that is, you can have multiple spirals you are stacked like this. So, you have got multiple spirals into this way, and then to match the capacity you are stacking them like this. Now, you have got a central feeder, centrally your say feeding system, and that slurry, that is again the challenge to the mechanical engineers. That is, how do I maintain the solid percentage solid concentration in my slurry, as well as the flow rate of the slurry in each spiral at a consistent rate, that is similar to your hydrocyclone what we did. So, this is all about spirals. So, next lecture we will start with another type of gravity concentration, and that will be the week 10th lecture. Till then, thank you very much.